From the clothes we wear to the cars we drive. From what we use to look good to what we use to relax. Our lives are full of products. And our products are full of animals. In the past few years, I've learned quite a lot about how the meat we eat reaches our plates. But I've always wondered what happens to the bits of the animal that we don't eat. And it turns out that these leftover parts are made into things we use every day.
That's a symbolic noise for, like, leather.
As well as some things we couldn't even imagine. To find out how, I'm going on an extraordinary journey to see these raw animal parts transformed into shiny new products. And I'm going to be joined by the people who use them to see what they make of it. And of course, the sheep need to get slaughtered.
Are we actually going to be in the room?
Oh, my God!
Mine had a testicle on it!
We'll be going behind the doors of unknown companies and into hidden worlds.
That is just such a weird vision. Just skin hanging there.
This is where we start to see what's inside the chest.
Getting hands-on.
I don't think that's going to go in there, Julie.
And discovering what makes these animal leftovers so indispensable.
Look at it!
What am I doing here with these? Could knowing that so many of our favourite items contain animals change the way we feel about them forever? Tonight, I'm looking at fish and seafood. Whether it's cod and chips or salmon sashimi, by the time our delicious seafood dishes have reached our plate, there's a trail of leftovers that some clever companies can turn into products. The heads, guts and bones of the fish we eat end up in all sorts of things, perfume, hairspray, even beer. But I want to know how they get in there and what they're doing in there.
Oh, oh yeah. That is really disgusting.
Oh. Not liking that?
No, not at all.
To find out, I'll be getting hands-on around the fishing hubs of Europe. I've got a bit of fish juice in my mouth then. Visiting manufacturers and factories to find out how they turn our fishy leftovers into some of our favourite items.
Oh, my God! It's a fish!
I've heard a lot of hair products contain fish byproducts, so I'm starting my journey in Iceland, one of the UK's major fish suppliers. I'm travelling to a town called Siglafjörður, 25 miles outside the Arctic Circle, to find out more. But I'm not doing this alone.
I'm Emily. I work in the beauty department of a London store.
I'm Rachel. I work as a model. Emily and I have been best friends since the start of secondary school. Both of us do take pride in our appearance. You know, we spend a lot of time doing each other's hair, makeup. I think society's got to a point now where image is everything. You have to look good.
You should try that on. It's really pretty. Yeah. I really like it.
Hair is a big part of that. I think it's probably one of the first things that you look at when you see somebody is their hair and what it's like.
For these girls, keeping up appearances means one thing, products.
Well, every other day I wash my hair, so I'm putting shampoo and conditioner in it. Then volumizing mousse.
Then I have a hair serum for the ends of my hair.
I will probably put a heat defencing spray to protect it from the blow drying.
A curl boosting mousse. A fabricator spray, which basically volumizes the roots.
After that, cover it with hairspray. And I'll reapply hairspray several times during the day.
And I thought I was high maintenance.
That's really nice. Good. Really nice and soft.
But how much do they know about what's in their products?
Do think about what goes into the products, but a lot of the time I don't understand what's written on the back of packets. You sort of get to a stage where you don't know what you're putting on.
So is there any ingredient that could put these girls off their beloved products?
I've been vegetarian for about 20 years. If I found out that my favourite hair product was animal tested or contained any raw animal product, blubber or, I don't know, some fish oils or something like that, I would be so upset, really upset.
From North London to the North Pole. Well, not quite the North Pole, but it's near enough. These girls are about to join me for a journey that could change their beauty regime forever. There's a fish byproduct called chitosan, used in some hair products, that increases hold without making the hair stiff. We're meeting Bjorn Valdimarsson from fishing company Rami to find out exactly how seafood ends up in hairspray.
Hello, hello. Nice to see you. Nice to see you. Hello. Right, say hello to Bjorn.
Hello.
Hi.
Welcome.
Hi.
Nice to meet you.
And we have to say welcome to Iceland, don't we?
Thank you.
Because this is the first time.
Yes,
it is. Absolutely. Definitely.
Any idea why you're here?
No.
There's the smell of fish at the moment.
Yeah, we can
the
smell. Got the smell.
Got the smell.
OK. Have you heard of a product called chitosan?
No,
we haven't.
Chitosan is found in hair products.
Right, never heard of it.
What is it, Bjorn?
Well, I will not tell you now. First, we will go to this boat, out to the sea, and then afterwards, you will find out what it is.
Exciting! Okay, let's go on the boat.
Let's begin the adventure. Come on, girls.
The trawler we're using can hold 20 tons of fish. It goes out in treacherous seas for 5 to 6 days, fishing deep in the Arctic Circle, where the water is purer.
Ever been fishing before?
Never.
No. Rachel?
No, I'm vegetarian, so I'm definitely not going to go fishing.
This is a tough job, in cramped conditions and freezing temperatures.
How do you feel about this, then?
A bit nervous.
What have fish got to do with hair? It's going to be quite interesting.
Yeah.
We're not going out as far as the fishermen normally do, but even these relatively calm waters will test our sea legs.
I'm feeling really seasick.
Yeah, okay, all right.
Genuinely a bit worried going to throw up.
Oh, no.
Are you okay?
Oh, don't film me being sick.
Are you feeling seasick?
A little bit, actually, no, a lot. Oh, dear.
You're not feeling well, lovely.
I'm not feeling very well.
Oh, God, poor thing.
It's the boat rocking up and down.
It's quite motiony, isn't it?
I'm all right. I'm fine when I'm looking at the horizon.
OK, keep looking then.
How are you doing?
Yeah, I'm all right.
You're coping?
I'm coping at the moment. Yeah.
I'm not letting a touch of nautical nausea hinder my mission. Unfortunately, ladies, you're going to have to suck it up. Well, not literally, though.
What are we fishing for today?
Today, we are fishing prawns.
Prawns?
Because you were asking about chitosan, and the answer to that question is in the prawns.
So chitosan comes from prawns?
Yeah.
Finally, we have the first piece of the hair product puzzle. Chitosan, which is a key ingredient of hairspray, comes from prawns. But I'm still not exactly sure how it ends up there. Below deck, a haul of prawns is dumped onto a conveyor belt, which the girls and I have to sort from other fish in the catch.
Goes in here.
All right.
OK.
Oh, my God!
Each haul is about 2 tonnes and takes around 8 hours to sift through.
OK, hurry.
Hey, good catch!
Owner Gustav insists that we work at the speed his crew normally work at, pulling out the unwanted fish, which, according to Bjorn, are sold at the local market.
But you use lots of hair products. You're a model.
I did not realise that they were using prawn in my hair.
No. I am never eating fish again.
You're never eating fish again?
No. I am never using hair products again.
Is that you're saying that? There's another under there.
Got one.
You're absolutely sure about that?
If this is going on my hair.
Well, we don't know how yet.
I don't know how, that is true, but...
It's raw inside, raw.
Oh, look, raw.
Raw.
What's that?
That's the eggs.
I really hope it's not the eggs that are going into my hair.
How are you feeling about hair products now, then?
I really don't know how I feel about hair products. I guess maybe fish oils or... That seems logical to go into a product, but... Prawns that didn't even cross my mind.
I want to see exactly what it is. I still haven't got it in my mind's eye.
No.
What this product is and how it makes its way into hair stuff.
Okay.
Thank you.
At this stage, there's still no obvious link to hairspray, so we follow the trail to the prawn factory. Here our catch is boiled and prepared for processing. It's just a small part of the 4.5 million prawns processed here every day.
So what's going on here, Bjorn?
This is a prawn peeling plant.
Prawn peeling.
And here we peel, clean and freeze and pack prawns.
And where do they go, the majority of these?
Most of these go to UK, to England. So if you buy a prawn sandwich when you go back home,
most
it might be from here.
Yeah,
here
we are in the history of the prawn. Where does the kaisan come from? Which bit of the prawn?
From the shells.
It is from the shells?
Yeah.
So it is all the leftover.
These are the peelers. The peelers, they take the shell from the prawns.
So the machine does it all? The machine takes the skin off the top?
Yes, the machine takes all the shells from the prawns.
And separates the meat and the rest of it.
Yeah.
From here, the prawns are checked by an ultraviolet machine for any remaining shell before being frozen, packed, and sent to Britain. But we're more interested in the stuff that's falling under the machines. What looks like waste, the antennae, the legs, the shells, is in fact a key ingredient in the global beauty industry.
Just shells. How does it become this product?
Yeah, that is the next part of the story. We have to go next door to another factory, and I will show you that.
Kaitazan comes from chitin, which is the major component of the prawn shell. It's the chitin that gives the shell its toughness and durability, so it can protect the soft tissues of the prawn. Although the value of chitin as a byproduct has been known for years, the lack of manufacturing facilities in the town meant the shells were simply dumped into the sea. In 1999, that changed. After 3 years of research, the company Primex developed the ability to turn raw shells into chitin on an industrial scale. Each one of these trucks contains 13 tonnes of shells, which will be processed into 250 kilos of chitin.
So I'm not putting that in my hair.
Chances are you already have. We asked the company's Sigur Vigvosdottir if we can get hands-on.
Can we go and have a go with the...
Oh, yes, of course you can.
Yeah?
You
want
to do that?
Yeah. Yeah. Come on, we're in. We're in it. Let's do it. Why do you use the hose? Why so much water?
It's very necessary for cleaning them and also to float them up.
Right.
To the tanks for their process.
It looks like prawn soup.
It really does. It doesn't look that appetizing and not something at the moment that I'd actually want to put on my hair either.
Having followed the prawn from the ocean, we finally get to see the first major transformation. After we hose them down, the shells are mixed with hydrochloric acid to remove the calcium, and then mixed with sodium hydroxide, which is commonly known as caustic soda, to remove protein and colour.
That's weird. Oh, it's like little particles of plastic.
According to Primex, removing protein lowers the risk of allergic reactions to shellfish.
It doesn't look like a shell or a meat. Nothing.
From here on in, the transformations are quicker and more dramatic.
Here we see the chitin.
Oh, wow!
The white sludge is pressed and dried into chitin. This sawdust-like material is what gives shells their strength.
It's not still chitosan.
Still not?
No. Now the next stage will be to convert it to chitosan.
Thank you.
So from factory floor to the science lab and chitin expert, Dr. Einar Mathiasson. Finally, we get to see some chitin.
So here you have it.
Yeah, here we have it.
All right, this we've seen before. This is like the sawdust.
Yeah, this is the chitin.
But this is finely chitosan,
yeah,
is it?
This is a final product with the unique properties.
It's just been ground down.
So it's processed into a powder.
Yeah. Mm.
So simply, in as non-scientific way as you can, tell me what this product is.
This is a long-chain biopolymer.
See, I said make it simple. It's a long-chain
biopolymer.
Biopolymer, yes. Yeah. How does it work in a hair product, in a hairspray? What does it do?
It increases shininess and the glossy of the product. It increases the volume. It prevents split ends of hair. Mm. Also kind of moisturizer as well, so.
So when you look at a hair product, why on the label doesn't it say that this is derived from an animal? It's an animal product, that it's just chitosan? Because we didn't know what chitosan was.
No,
you'd
no.
never
you
know.
You look at that and you'd never think that was an animal.
Well, it's mainly because this is a well-known raw material to the industry and they don't have to say exactly where it comes from.
And do you only find chitosan in prawns?
No, you find it in fungi and mushrooms.
But you mostly supply the hair industry with chitosan.
Yeah.
So the chances are that it's prawn derived chitosan. Can you answer this question? Here you've got this powder. How does it become the hair product?
Well, I think you have to ask the manufacturer who is buying this from us because he has all the secrets.
Ah, so this scientist isn't revealing.
No.
So we haven't quite finished our journey.
This eye-opening journey feels like it's finally reaching its conclusion. It's amazing to follow a process like this. And now for the final step, the product. It's a surprisingly simple process when you know how. The basic ingredients for making hairspray are chitosan, water, citric acid, and ethanol. The first step is to add chitosan to water. Citric acid helps the chitosan to dissolve and make a thicker solution, which when mixed further becomes a gel. Ethanol is then mixed into the gel. Ethanol makes the gel dry quicker when applied to the hair. Once dry, it hardens, holding the hair in any style you like. Just not that one. Making hairspray follows the same process, but more water and ethanol are added to make a more diluted solution, which can then be sprayed. The other ingredients added by manufacturers are the perfumes, colours and preservatives. And there you have it. Prawns. Hairspray. As well as making our hair funky, chitosan has some amazing properties that have led to the development of new wound healing creams and diet pills.
It wasn't so long ago that we were out there fishing for the little prawns.
I don't have an issue because I eat the prawns, so that's for me is fine. The fact that the shell is used in this way, that it's this miracle product, I think it's fantastic.
Vegetarian. Moral dilemma. What are you going to do now about your hair products?
Personally, for ethical reasons, now I know that it has come from a creature, that I'm going to go home and check all of my products and any ones that do contain the ingredient, I think, will be checked out. I just couldn't use it. I've been imagining the prawns on my hair otherwise.
No, so. I just have a newfound respect for the humble prawn.
Yeah.
If Rachel was freaked out by prawns and hairspray, I wonder how she'd feel about whales in perfume.
That's why I'm really interested in ambergris. I know it's a substance that comes from whales, and I know it's been prized in the perfume industry for centuries, but I don't know exactly what it is, and I don't know if it's still used today.
Where once an A-list film star may have endorsed a perfume, nowadays even wags are releasing their own ranges. The latest figures show UK retailers sold over £1 billion of perfume, up nearly 9% on the previous year. I wonder how many people know their perfumes may contain something that comes from a whale. Whale.
Ugh!
Whale.
Well, I definitely do know that.
What would you think of that?
Surprise and shock.
Don't buy it.
Don't have to call you perfume again.
Now, I had the same reaction when I found out about ambergris. Whales aren't fish, they're mammals, and hunting them is cruel, unethical, and unacceptable. I love my perfumes, but...
if it's got whale on the label, for me, it's a big, fat, non-negotiable no. I'm aware that ambergris has a real mystique around it. Medieval mariners called it floating gold. The ancient Chinese called it dragon spittle. But commercial whale hunting has been illegal for a quarter of a century. So the first thing to find out is if ambergris is still being used.
Perfume recipes are closely guarded secrets. So will I be able to get a top perfumier to share some of the secrets with me if I'm really nice?
Florist perfumier on London's Jermyn Street has a client list stretching back to the year 1730. They've made perfumes for kings and queens, prime ministers, movie stars, even Ian Fleming, the creator of James Bond. I'm hoping to apply some 007-style charm on head perfume designer Sheila Foyle to see if she'll reveal the company secrets, starting with the use of animal parts.
Are animal parts or byproducts used in perfumes these days?
We used to obtain musk from the musk pods which were removed from the deer. I believe it's their scent marking glands. In times gone by, they were worth more than their weight in gold.
But to remove the pod, you need a dead deer.
From castoreum.
What's castoreum?
Came from a beaver. We've used ingredients from civet cat, and to obtain that, the cat is irritated by often poking with sticks or some other process, and then it's milked.
So would it be fair to say it's frowned upon to use any real animal part or animal product today in the perfume industry?
We use the man-made synthetic alternatives. We just don't want to use anything that causes harm.
But is it used, to your knowledge, would anything from an animal be used? And not necessarily, you know, something that would harm the animal, but...
I would think that the only natural ingredient that is probably still used may be ambergris.
It's funny you should mention ambergris, because that's what I'm on a mission to find out about. I know that it's something to do with whales, which I'm not happy about at all. You obviously don't use it.
We don't use it, no.
Do you know where I can get any ambergris, where I can see some, smell some?
What, natural ambergris?
Yeah.
I've no idea.
Tricky, then.
Yeah.
Very tricky.
Yeah. I can't let it
out. Now, if animal parts from deer, beavers and cats are no longer used to make us smell good, why are whale parts still used? I think I'm going to need to get my hands on some actual ambergris to find out. After a bit more research, I found a perfume place called Le Labo. Packaged in a contemporary style, this shop sells 13 fragrances, which are prepared in front of the customer and personalised with a printed name tag. I've heard they might have some ambergris products, and I'm meeting lab assistant Sandy Sidhu to find out.
I'm really interested in this product called ambergris. Do you have it here?
I'm afraid we don't have it here, but what we do have is the synthetic musk equivalent to the ambergris,
okay,
which is actually the ambroxan, which is over here.
It's actually a nice smell.
Yes, it's very subtle but very sensual, and it's very, very long-lasting on the skin. It's one of those scents that you want to keep smelling.
Do you think I'm going to get my hands on the real thing?
I'm afraid I don't think that would be possible. What we use is the ambrox, which is a synthetic musk, which you usually can get. What I can tell you is actually that ambergris is taken from the sperm whales, but it's very, very rare as well. You might want to try and go out to sea.
Come on, Sandy, be a bit more encouraging.
Right, I've learned that ambergris is still being used in perfumes, and it comes from a sperm whale. It's time to find out what it is and why it's okay to use it.
So far, no real ambergris, but I've been given a tip-off about a perfumier called Roger Dove, and he may be able to help me. He's a big noise in the nose world.
Roger Dove is a fragrance academic, historian and author. I've been told I'll be in the presence of the Prince of Perfume.
Ambergris, have I been saying it correctly?
Ambergris, most people in Britain would call it ambergris.
Ambergris, OK.
Grey amber.
Grey amber. I haven't actually come across the real deal, the product itself yet. Uh-huh. Does it still exist?
Ambergris itself exists because it's a natural phenomenon. It's a natural excretion from the whales.
Ambergris is formed when sperm whales swallow squid. The squid have hard, parrot-like beaks which can't be digested and irritate the intestine of the whale.
And a natural defence is that the whale starts to form a waxy paste around the beak, a little bit like a grain of sand in an oyster forms a pearl. But the problem is this waxy piece gets bigger and bigger, and the whale needs to expel it. It's a little bit like a cat honks up a furball. It's the same sort of thing. And so the waxy paste floats on the oceans, and in fact, for ambergris to be used in traditionally in perfumery, we have to take it from the sea because an oxidation occurs on the ambergris, uh-huh. and it's the reaction of the salt and the sun which gives ambergris its odour.
Would whales ever be hunted for this product? No. It wouldn't be extracted from inside the whale?
To my knowledge, I might be wrong, but I don't believe it's ever been hunted, the whale has been hunted for ambergris, because it would be useless. It would have no odour for us.
So it has to have been honked?
It has to have been honked. Honking is essential.
So there you have it. Whale puke plus some salty sea air equals the perfect perfume ingredient.
Is it still used today in the industry?
To my knowledge, yes. If somebody is making a very, very luxurious scent, then natural ambergris is something maybe they might choose to still use within the formula.
So there are a few perfumeries in the world that will have a supplier of ambergris.
Yes, yes.
So if your budget will stretch to a luxury brand, you'll find ambergris in scents made by top labels like Hermes, Balmain, and what's believed to be the Beckham's favourite, Creed.
Now, do you have any? Me to look at, to touch.
Funny enough, I do.
It looks like a huge truffle.
Well, yeah. It's the most unlikely looking stuff.
Oh, I mean, it doesn't.
And it doesn't smell most likely how you might imagine.
No, it doesn't. Can we touch it?
Yeah.
We're allowed?
Do. Take it out.
Take it out.
So this is it. I'm holding a whale byproduct and I'm feeling okay about it. Well, as okay as you can feel holding whale puke.
Now, don't reach over and punch me, but it smells a bit sicky. What's its importance within the perfume structure?
Ambergris's structure is made up of cholesterol, which is a fat. This fattiness, or the oiliness, is what helps hold all the other raw materials on the skin. So it makes not only it last a long time, but it makes other raw materials that sit with it last a long time too. Man has used this raw material and known of it for at least 3,000 years. It's part of the magic and it's part of what is incredible about the gifts that nature gives us.
So there is whale in perfume, but it's an excretion, not a body part, and it's not something I'm angry about. I wonder what the consumers think.
Vomit. Yeah!
I wouldn't want to wear those perfume.
How does that smell good?
Well, there you go. Somehow it manages it.
Oh, okay.
Difficult to believe,
yeah.
Huh?
Yeah, that's really odd.
But it still smells nice, so why not?
There you go.
Cool, thank you very much. I got a fish in my dish. From ambergris to amber nectar. And I'm feeling fine.
I got a fish in my dish. What I'm discovering is the more you scratch the surface of the fish's anatomy, the more everyday products you find fish in, including one of the nation's favourite, booze. How many people know that? Let me just ask you, there's a fish product that they use in beer. Do you know what it is?
A fish product?
Their oil or something? No.
I wouldn't have a clue.
Urine?
Their guts or something?
The scales?
Blood, I suppose, would be horrendous to be drinking. What else might be in there?
I found out there's this product called Isinglass, which apparently they use in beers.
It comes from a fish. And somehow it gives beer its golden glow. I'm meeting some beer drinkers to find out more.
I'm Tamir Kendler.
I'm Tom. The boys call me Kev.
My name's Chris. The boys call me Tinny.
My drinking team has a rugby problem.
Yeah. Come to uni and you want to join the rugby team, I think people just expect, sort of, like you will be drinking.
We got an away match, we'd start drinking as soon as we finished the game in the change rooms. Hopefully we've had a win and we're all in good spirits to start drinking there. There isn't much I wouldn't drink
We drank urine out of a pint. Dog food. Sick.
So what if their beer had fish in it? Would they drink that?
I don't think I would have ever thought about what goes into a beer purely because you just never consider it.
So, do they know what beer's made of?
Water.
Water?
It must be made of water to some extent. It's liquid.
Everything's
yeah.
Water.
I didn't even know that, mate.
OK, do they even know what makes it alcoholic?
I don't know. What does make it alcoholic?
Oh.
I have no idea.
We drink so much of it, the fact that we don't know what is in it is quite scary.
A night on the booze hasn't put them off a 4 a.m. start at Billingsgate.
I don't know what I'm looking at now.
It really is a weird place for beer to begin its journey. I'm hoping the boys will be as curious as I am. Is it a head? Is it an eye? Is it blood?
Chris, Kev, Temmie, morning, lads.
Hello.
Morning, how are we doing?
Yeah, fantastic.
It's early. What do you think we're doing at this ungodly hour at Billingsgate Market?
At a fish market, something to do with beer, not a clue.
Yeah.
There's a product in beer called isinglass, or isinglass, apparently.
From a fish?
All right, cool.
What do you think about the fact that there's something fishy in your beer? Does that put you off beer?
A little bit.
Not yet, because you don't know what it is?
Yeah.
OK, come on.
CJ Jackson, the director of Billingsgate Seafood Training School, will enlighten us.
CJ, we know that there's something called isinglass in beer, but what is it?
It actually is a dried swim bladder of a fish.
What's a swim bladder?
A swim bladder is like the buoyancy aid. It basically keeps round fish upright. And in the 18th century, they used to take the swim bladder from a beluga sturgeon. Today, beluga sturgeons are really endangered. It's also one of the most valuable caviar producers that you can get. So what they're using now is a fish called Vietnamese catfish or pangasius.
Yeah. Mm-hmm.
Most of it actually is now processed abroad and it comes in frozen.
Pangasius is mostly farmed in Vietnam. It can grow up to 3 metres long. As it's hard to find whole ones in the UK, we're going to see the same principle on a much smaller scale. Say hello to Gary the Gurnard.
Look at his eyes. They're fantastic.
But he feels so rubbery.
It's pretty cool. He's a little weird-looking fella.
Yeah, he's good-looking. See,
there's
little bits here.
Temmie, you're going to have to get much closer than that, love.
I'm so worried. It's like, oh, is it like going to be a lion that just jump up at me?
It goes in your pint.
When you open these fish up, you very often find the swim bladder in the middle. So what I'm going to do is take you upstairs, show you how to prepare it, and we're going to see if we can find the swim bladder.
So one of Britain's great pastimes, getting bladdered, relies on bladders. For me, dissecting this little fishy will be more fascinating than shocking. Will it be the same for the rugby lads?
We're going to cut underneath that dorsal spine. Don't worry. What you need to do is twist the knife so that it's pointing towards the head.
There we go, done.
Okay.
How did that feel, Temmie?
I'm struggling.
I'm going to insert the scissors into the back of the head of the fish. Okay. And then just gently push.
Oh. Not liking that?
No, not at all. That wasn't nice.
You're going to bend the fish down.
Oh,
and as you bend...
Oh, yeah, mate, I don't want it to splat
it's
on
not
me.
Gonna splat, and then what I'm going to do is put my finger in there and just gently ease back.
This is great. We've got the fish bladder intact. There's still some gas in there. Having pulled that back, so you can see the swim bladder.
Bend it right down.
Oh, look, there we go.
Can you see the swim bladder? That's it, perfect.
That's not the bladder. Yeah, that's one as well.
Yeah,
there we go.
Excellent. So that's the bit that you're going to use.
What I still don't quite understand is how it's used in beer.
Well, I know they dry it, but when it actually comes to the actual function and how they actually use it, you need to speak to a brewer.
And going to a brewery can't happen soon enough for Temmie. I've managed to get beer historian Peter Hayden to show us around his specialist brewery in Greenwich, South London.
Peter. Hi, Peter, how are you?
Hello. Welcome.
Thank you very much. You're the guys. You've got Kevin, Chris and Temmie.
Nice to meet you, Chris.
Hello, guys.
Nice to meet you.
Welcome to Meantime.
Nice to meet you.
Thank you very much.
Let's go.
Right. Contain yourselves. We're going into a brewery.
I get the impression the boys are in heaven. Here, the four elements of water, malt.
Nice smell.
Yeah. Hops and yeast combine to make beer.
I've heard two different pronunciations, isinglass and isinglass.
The word isinglass originates from Dutch because when we started using it industrially in this country in around about the 1730s, the Dutch word huizen means sturgeon and blas means bladder. So huizen blas is sturgeon bladder and the anglicised version would be isinglass.
That makes sense. Whoa. What's that, Peter?
This is a fish maw.
Which is a swim bladder?
Effectively, yeah. Which is the raw material from which we make isinglass. What this is pure protein. It's a protein called collagen. It's the same thing as some people, some ladies like to put in their lips to make them bigger. So...
Don't look at me. Don't look at me.
So, yeah, it's a very, very pure and natural form of protein.
What does it smell like?
Pretty plain.
Yeah, nothing.
I was hoping I'd get something crazy. This must have come from a massive fish, because the ones we saw earlier were literally
tiny
little things. So.
Yeah. So how does that end up as isinglass?
And there are a couple of manufacturers in the UK who produce this for the brewing industry. They will take the raw material, process it firstly into a powder, which some people may wish to use, and there are a number of options. It can then be turned into a paste, or finally, in the format that we're going to use it.
So that's like a glue.
That is gloopy. Yeah. So could I drink that or would I get ill?
Yeah. You could drink that.
Blimey, these lads really will drink anything.
In one. Oh, yeah, it's horrible. I wouldn't want to drink that. It just looks far too gloopy and a strange colour and I don't know, I don't think I'd fancy it.
Can we see this in action now, how it actually works?
Yeah, by all means.
OK.
Isinglass is used in the production of many cask ales, some stouts and a few lagers. The yeast content of beer makes it cloudy. When mixed with isinglass, yeast molecules stick to isinglass molecules and fall to the bottom. Normally, it would take around 4 days for the yeast to settle in this keg. Isinglass does it in just 6 hours, making the whole process a lot quicker.
So, Kev, if you want to do the honours.
Let's have a look at this.
Da-da-da!
Wow. That's ridiculous.
You can see through that one.
Yeah, that's just
you
see the bubble glass.
Can I see you? Let's look. Oh, yes, I can. Hello.
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 So if isinglass falls to the bottom of the barrel, does Peter think there's any of it left in the drink?
It's not. You insist it's not a part of the beer. It's not a part of the mix.
And as the clumps get bigger, gravity takes over and pulls everything out of solution to become a sediment at the bottom of the container.
Studies agree that in the majority of cases, isinglass is undetectable in the finished pint. But some bottle-conditioned ales and cask ales, if served from too near the bottom of the barrel, may still contain minute amounts. To find out that something as obscure as a fish bladder goes into some of our favourite beers has been a real eye-opener. It's time to find out if a little fishy has put these rugby boys off their pint.
Guys, I found the whole process today really interesting and fascinating, but it hasn't put me off at all because even the product, like the swim bladder, the final product, fish oils used in lots of food and ingredients, fish products are used in lots of food and ingredients. There was nothing squeamish about it for me. What about you?
When you were cutting open the fish and stuff and you saw it there and all the blood and guts and stuff, it's a bit, you know, but when you see it all dried out and then the liquid, it doesn't put me off at all.
Temmie, you were a little bit different at the beginning of the day.
I know, it was a bit squeamish to start off with. To be honest, it is part of my life anyway. It's part of my lifestyle, so I'm not going to give it up that easy.
If you want to have a beer, you have to put up with the fact that there was a fish bladder in it.
Cheers, guys.
Cheers.
Good day. Thank you. Cheers.
Who would have thought a fish bladder could help brighten our booze?
for the next surprising discovery, I'm on the motorway heading to Manchester. When I think of Manchester, I don't really think of fish. I think of industrial landscapes, football teams, and of course, music. Over the decades, Britain has been rocking to the sound of Manchester bands like The Smiths, Oasis, The Stone Roses, Take That, and even the Bee Gees. The question is, what are they doing in a film about fish byproducts? I'm about to find out. Jed Green makes and repairs guitars for rock stars. His clients include Sinead O'Connor, Badly Drawn Boy, The Zootons, Gary Barlow, and some others he's not allowed to reveal. I'm following the fish trail to his workshop in Manchester.
I know nothing except that there is a fish part or some part of the fish that's utilised in the manufacturing and creation of guitars. Is it the inside of the fish or the outside of the fish?
I'd say the outside.
So the scales?
No, they don't have scales.
So we're going for shellfish?
Yes.
Right.
That's right.
Okay, moving on to the guitar then. Is it the string?
No.
Is it in here?
Yes.
So it's some sort of shell?
It is.
Oyster shells?
No, these are abalone and pearl.
The wonderful abalone.
Abalone is a type of sea snail found in the oceans around South Africa and New Zealand.
Oh, where is that?
That is an abalone. It's also known as ear shell and mutton fish. It might not look like much, but it's considered a delicacy. I describe it as a kind of giant scallop. Once the meat is removed, the shells can be polished, revealing a beautiful array of colours.
How are you showing me that? Because that's what it is.
That's on you every day.
You certainly do.
But it isn't just Jed who does this. If you're thrashing away on any half-decent guitar in your mum's garage, chances are it's got some of this stuff in it.
So we were talking about shells. Mollusks, indeed.
Mm-hmm. Oh. Show me your mollusks.
Here's one I prepared earlier.
So this is an abalone shell.
Yeah, I think this is possibly New Zealand or Tasmania, which seems to be the main source. Mm. When it's sort of stuck to a rock or something, there's little tentacles out the side. And these are allegedly breathing holes.
Do they arrive in this form for you?
No, it doesn't come like that. It comes in slices. Ah. It's bought by the ounce. This is a fingerboard for a guitar. So you cut a little pocket for it to sit in.
Yeah.
That gets glued in.
And is this expensive?
Enough to do that neck would be about £40.
So it is expensive?
Yeah. These are different tops for guitars. What's interesting here is you can see the colour changing. They're all different. You get greens, blues.
Lots of purples going on here.
Look at that purple there. Absolutely fantastic. I've seen guitars going back to 1500s. And all the adornment on them was all this sort of work.
So even back then, even the early versions of the guitar?
I think it probably goes back to Egyptian times and pre that.
Will you let me loose on one of your guitars?
No. We could try and turn this into something. Yeah.
I like that idea, yeah.
You can see that basically that would probably come out of
there.
Out of that.
All right, let's have a go. So hold it fairly tight.
He won't let me anywhere near the guitars, but he'll let me have a go at milling some shell into a beautiful piece of guitar decoration.
You know what it smells like? It smells like when you're in the dentist.
Yep.
Bit more?
A lot more.
They're tough beasties.
Oh, gosh. We're getting some of it. Ah!
At this point, I should say neither Jed nor I have done this before.
There must be a better method.
No wonder he wouldn't let me loose on the guitars. So, shells in guitars. It's not as weird as fish bladder in beer, or prawn shell in hairspray. But none of these things are as weird as what I'm about to see next.
One part of the fish's body I'm surprised to find there's a use for is the skin, and I don't really think about fish skin and glamour. Eel skin, yes, shark skin come across before, but fish skin in fashion? Intrigued.
Now, I like my fish skin crispy. Some of you may like it peeled off. But now the likes of Dior, Gucci and Prada have taken fish skin off the dinner table and put it onto the catwalk. For those of us suffering from recession immunity, designer trainers and handbags made of fish leather could be one way to make a noisy fashion statement. In 2003, the main fish leather supplier in Iceland sold 15,000 square feet of fish leather. Last year, that jumped up to 106,000 square feet. I'm visiting the Nordestrand fish factory in the north of Iceland to find out how fish turns into leather. Showing me around is manager Gummi St. Jonsson.
Hi, Gummi.
Hello, Julia.
Nice
Welcome
to meet you.
Nordestrand, Alvik.
Thank you very much. OK, what do you do here?
We are a processing plant.
Yep.
And we process, for example, from wool fish.
Wool fish.
This is a wool fish.
And what do you do with that fish? Do you use the entire fish?
Yeah, more or less we use the entire fish. We use the skin to make leather.
Okay, yes.
We make portion from the fish.
So from the actual meat?
Yeah, and from the head and the bones to animal food.
Pet food,
yes.
So how does this become leather?
Let me show you, Julia. We go in there, mm-hmm. and we put some clothes on and you try yourself.
All right, then. Hmm. I presume I'm going to have to touch them.
Fish from all over Iceland arrives here on a daily basis. It's mostly cod and wolf fish. This, which is my favourite dish. The head and guts are removed before being filleted by skilled workers who can slice through 5,000 wolf fish in a shift.
When all is ready,
I'm about to get a masterclass from the fastest filleter in the fjord. Christian can fillet an amazing 4 fish a minute.
First of all, you want to hold your knife like that.
Yep.
If you take the flap over here, and then you just cut
under
down
there,
as close to the bone as possible.
Yeah, I can feel the bone.
Yeah. Turn your knife like that, mm-hmm. and start cutting gently down, and try to follow the bone. Just wash your fingers.
It's very, very slimy. I can feel the bones. I think I might have done something wrong here.
Yeah, probably you went too through. You just follow that, yeah. Okay. Yeah.
Okay.
Take it off. Yeah.
So there's my fillet, which is a bit of a bloody mess, isn't it? Look. Yeah. Now let's see yours, Christian. Look at that. I mean, that's just perfect and beautifully done.
Oh, I hope I do a better job taking the skin off.
Just take a fillet.
Yep.
Put it skin down.
Yes.
And the tail part in first. I'll turn it on the machine.
So tail that way, right?
Yeah.
So just pop it down on there.
Yeah. Like this.
That's it.
Yeah.
So this is a fantastic contraption.
It's a lot more easier than filleting.
Yeah?
Oh, this is the wrong side.
Whoa!
Oh, you put it upside down.
No problem. I've got a bit of fish juice in my mouth then.
Ah.
Oh dear, they've got to cut that one out. How's that? Oh, look, we've still got a bit of skin to get off
there.
Yeah,
let's just put it aside.
Oh dear.
Of course, I'm only imagining that's what Gummi is saying, but this could have been a nice handbag. Maybe it's the lack of daylight in Iceland that's sending me a bit potty, but I soon get into the groove.
Now I'm getting a feel for it, so it's placing the tail down and release the wolf fish.
2 to 3 tons of skins pass through this machine every week before being graded for size and quality.
Okay, is that a good one or a bad one?
For the leather, we prefer the big size. It has no holes.
So that goes in this box full of ice?
Yeah. This one put here, it's too small.
The skins that don't make it, where do they go?
They go to pet food.
And where am I taking this now, Gummi?
You have to take this to the tanning company in Sauðárkrókur.
Soy de la croca.
Soy de la croca.
Soy de la croca.
Yes.
Soy de la croca. Right. Right, off to Soy de la croca I go.
After just a few hours in the factory, it's dark again. I'm on my way to Atlantic Leather Tannery. This is one of only a handful of places in the world that makes fish leather. I'm really curious to find out how such a fragile skin becomes tough enough to make leather. My guide here will be Boss Gunstein.
Gunstein, hello. Hi there.
Hi.
There we go. There's a gift for you.
Oh, thank you.
Some lovely soggy fish skins, ready to be turned into leather. What do we do first?
First we go through the fleshing machine.
Fleshing.
Fleshing.
Lovely, that
Let's
sounds
see.
Nice. So the machine is shaving off the rest of the flesh.
Yes, we have our knives in there that remove the flesh from the skin.
You're just left with this.
Now we go to the drum for the tanning.
Okay.
Tanning involves putting skins into a drum and mixing them with chemicals like chromium. Left untreated, the skins will simply decompose, but over a week in a drum, the chemicals change the structure of the proteins in the skin.
It started to be a little bit of water.
Creating a durable piece of leather from which it's possible to make lots of groovy things.
There we get...
Oh, look.
Fully tanned bullfish.
Wow. Oh, it feels all spongy now. So how long has that been spinning in the drum for?
1 week.
1 week?
Yes.
Is it the same process with fish skin as it is with other hides?
No. The basic difference between fish skins and other hides is that the fish is cold blood. The temperature they tolerate before boiling is only 28 degrees. When we started to develop this, we made thousands of gallons of fish soup.
Right.
For me, the capacity to turn fragile fish skin into durable leather...
There's no way you're going to tear this.
..is the most surprising aspect of this process. But I'm wondering what other surprises Gunstein has in his Willy Wonka-esque tannery.
This is ostrich legs.
Is it? Ostrich legs?
Yes. You see?
Yeah.
If you think that's weird, Gunstein also does a line of testicle purses and psychedelic furs. These are animals found dead in the wild and collected by the tannery.
So what's spinning around in there?
Here we have salmon.
Salmon?
Yes.
So you can use salmon skin as well?
Oh, yes.
Can you use any fish skin?
Theoretically, yes.
So you could make a handbag out of your goldfish if you wanted to?
Yes. Here's salmon.
Look at that. That is amazing. This is more like snake skin, isn't it?
The pockets, how they're amazing.
Yeah.
Feel how thin it is and how strong it is.
Yeah, that's brilliantly strong.
I'm now on a real mission to see it become a fashion item. After being dyed, the leather's stretched on a board and dried overnight. Then it's softened.
Now it's just like nice, squidgy, soft leather.
And prepared for the final finish.
So you're putting a bit of Christmas wrapping paper onto some salmon skins.
Yes, we're doing that. This is one of the type of the finish we can do.
OK.
Let's see. Let me take this.
Oh, it's like a big pizza.
It's like a big pizza, yeah. Put this in.
Yeah. Do that.
And close this for me.
OK.
Up it go. Let's see. Now I pull this little bit out.
Yeah.
Not too bad.
Oh, just
this. It's a yes. It's a heart.
Let's see. Feel it back from here.
Here you go.
Look at that glittery, shiny disco salmon skin.
Oh yeah. It's like a rainbow.
Can you imagine the shoes? I'm wearing them in my head. I'm going disco dancing. That's brilliant.
Seeing a salmon turned into a designer handbag is about as weird as, well, seeing a salmon turned into a designer handbag. I wonder what the great British public will think.
What do you think that's made out of?
leather with a snake skin effect on it.
Snake or alligator.
If it was by a designer, like a proper diet, it'd probably be like snake.
I would say crocodile.
Crocodile?
Snake?
Snake.
Yeah.
I wouldn't say it's an animal.
No, not an animal.
You don't think it's an animal?
No.
No?
No? Shall I show you what it is?
Okay.
Yeah. Oh my god! It's a fish!
Surprised?
Wow!
Fish. Wow!
No way!
Really? Oh, right!
It's a fish skin.
A fish?
Oh my gosh! I never would have thought that!
Neither would have I.
Completely surprised?
Oh, yeah, definitely.
And there's no need for the boys to feel left out. It's not just handbags that come from salmon.
And you can turn it into pretty much everything.
Yes. We have shoes like this that
those.
You can get in the UK.
They're very cool. And what's this? This is salmon.
This is salmon skin.
So salmon skin high tops.
Yeah.
So who do you supply?
We supply all the big names: Dior, Gucci, Prada, Ferragamo, Donna Karan. So there's a wide range of customer.
Next time I'm tucking into my cod and chips, I think I might just keep the skin.
I'm completely amazed that fish like haddock and salmon, and potentially even your goldfish, can be turned into designer shoes and bags.
In this film, I wanted to find out how the products that fill our lives are full of seafood. Who'd have thought that prawn shells make hairspray, that fish bladders make beer, and that whale puke can help make perfume? The main thing I've noticed is that although the consumers I met were pretty disgusted at the beginning of the process, by the time we got to the end product, they were okay with it. How about you?
Next time, I revisit my best moments from the series.
My heart is going sick.
These are bone cutters.
That's keeping you alive. Yeah.
What have we got in our hand?
The beef intestines.
I wouldn't associate a cow with a book.
It was all horrible, I didn't like it, and now I like it. Now it's nice. I got a fish
in my dish. Julie is back with the best bits from the series tomorrow night at 9. As part of Extraordinary Me, follow the lives of three teenage girls as they cope with the pressure of growing up with a mum behind bars. Prison, Mum and Me, brand new next Tuesday at 9 on BBC Three.